New topic, that is principles of PGM we will be seeing today. Okay, so what are the theories underlying this particular system? We will see in a nutshell, and then we will be seeing in detail what are those principles. Okay, so the introduction principles are given in the first module, and the second module and third and fourth are the different types of the graphical models, and fifth is how the learning and inference takes place, and the sixth is our application. Okay, now coming to the first principle behind the PGM is the probability theory. So the complex systems will be characterized by some interrelated aspects which may be related to a reasoning task. So these systems, we will call them to be characterized by a set of random variables. And these variables can be either binary in nature or continuous in nature. Okay, so these are so generally when I see the data, okay, what are the data, the attributes corresponding to the data or columns of your data set, database, is nothing but some variables, okay, and the variables can be of two nature, that is binary or continuous in nature. Okay, generally we will try to confine our studies to binary one. You know why? Because that will reduce our computational complexity. Okay, so even if, for example, if I have salary, okay, as a particular variable, what I can do with that particular salary is, like, I can discretize that particular salary. Okay, so my annual salary of a particular person can range from, the monthly salary can range from, say, 10,000 to, say, 3 lakh or 4 lakh. It can be. Okay, so what I can do is, like, this same salary, I can divide it into low salary, medium salary, high salary, very high salary, and so on. Okay, this type of discretization is the better option. Why? Because then the number of variables that you are dealing with will be easy to interpret. Otherwise, what happens, you take it as a continuous variable, then you have a lot of interpretations required in that, and it will unnecessarily increase the complexity of the system. Okay, so generally we will try to stick to binary, and binary in the sense discrete nature. Continuous nature also can be included, but it will complicate the system. Now, here is an example for a binary variable. Okay, for flu, for example, flu can be present or absent. That is a binary variable. And fever, or that is your body temperature, is said to be a continuous variable. That is, you can tell in Fahrenheit as 99.123, etc., up to 102, 103, 104, etc. Okay, not more than 104, then people will die, I think, 105 or 106. Okay, so your body temperature can vary from 98 to 106 max. I'm just giving an example. So that is a continuous variable wherein you have to consider the elements in between. So the set of possible variables and their values is an important design decision and depends on the question we wish to answer about the domain. As I told you, why this is a very important design decision, because if I consider the continuous variable, I have to do the analysis. The analysis will go to a different strength, different level, and you have a lot of computational problems. Okay, but I don't say that you have to continuously omit this particular continuous variable only, because there are some cases in which you have to consider also. Okay, so whether to consider or not is your design decision. And what I am telling is, like, if possible, try to avoid it so that you will have a compact system and you will be able to get the results in a faster manner. Now, coming to probability theory, the task of PGM is to reason probabilistically about the values of one or more variables given observations about some others. Okay, now if I have observation of one variable, I want to know what is the relation between. Is there any reason that this particular variable is giving this value because of some other variable? Okay, that is why what we are trying to understand, whether the variables are related to each other. If the variables are related to each other, then we have more interest. Okay, why? Because that will help give me more information about the different aspects of the system. Okay. Now, this is done by constructing a joint distribution over the possible assignments. So you will be, assignments means nothing but the variables that we have. So we try to find the joint distribution of these variables to understand if there is any relationship between these variables. And this will allow us to answer a broad range of queries. Okay, so this is the role of probability theory in the PGM network. Now we will see with an example. Okay, so here is an example of a simple medical diagnosis system. Okay, a very small part of it. That is, you have a season. Okay, so based on the season, you have two different types of fevers. One is flu and the other is hay fever. Okay, in the flu, you have two symptoms. That is, muscle pain is there and chest congestion is there. But hay fever will not be accompanied by muscle pain, but only congestion will be there. Okay, so we are going to see only a snapshot of the PGM system. So this is a graphical representation of the medical diagnosis, a simple medical diagnosis system. Okay, now coming to our theory. Okay, now what we are discussing, we are discussing about the probability theory. Okay, what is the role of probability theory in the PGM networks? Okay, now here we are considering two diseases, flu and hay fever. They are not mutually exclusive. What do you mean by not mutually exclusive? A patient can have either flu or hay fever, or both of them, or none. Okay, because they are having same symptoms, or there are diseases with similar symptoms. Okay, they can have both of them together also. They can have either flu or hay fever also. And you have, they will not be having any two of these two diseases, but will be, and they will be having another disease. So they are not mutually exclusive. I hope you understand what is mutually exclusive. That is, if I have one, then I can by default say that this other thing is not there. So if I have flu, I can completely eliminate that I will not be having a hay fever. Then we call it as a mutually exclusive event. Okay, so here you can have both hay fever and flu. That is why it is not mutually exclusive. Both of them can be appearing together, or it will not occur only. So all the options are there. Like, it may be neither flu nor hay fever, but something else also. Okay, hope this much is clear. Now coming to our problem. Okay, so what are variables we are having in this particular case? So here is the case. You have season, flu, hay fever, muscle pain, and congestion. Okay, so if I consider these variables, for example, muscle pain can be there or not. So it is a binary variable. That is, muscle pain exists or not exist. Congestion also is a binary variable. That is, congestion can exist or not exist. Flu is also a binary variable. Flu may be present or absent. Hay fever is also a binary variable, which is present or absent. And season is having four elements in it, because we have summer, winter, autumn, spring. Okay, so that is because we are talking about European system. So these are the seasons. We have rainy season instead of autumn and all. Okay, so that season will vary from place to place. So here we consider four valued random variable season. Okay, so season can be given as 1, 2, 3, 4. That corresponds to the season. One can be summer, two can be winter, three can be autumn, and four can be spring. Okay, so like that you can have four variables. Okay, now if I considered our probability space, what is the probability space you are having with these five variables? You have five variables here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, season, flu, hay fever, muscle pain, and congestion. So with these five variables, our probability space is 2, because the 2 is for muscle pain, 2 is for congestion, 4 is for season, 2 is for flu, and 2 is for hay fever. So together I will be having 64 values for these five variables. Okay, this we are only taking a very simple medical diagnosis system. Remember like that. Okay, so this is just probability space for this particular 5 variables. So if I have more and more variables, this probability space keeps on increasing. And here you remember that it is all discrete, all are binary variable, and one is discrete variable, which is having, which is season, which is having 4 variables, four choices. Okay, or 4 events are there. So this is the distribution that we are having. Now, when I consider the joint distribution, okay, now if there is someone asking you, how likely the patient is to have a flu, given it is 4, has sinus congestion, and no, okay, not chest congestion, sinus congestion, and no muscle pain. Okay, now if I want to evaluate this, okay, when I want to evaluate this, what I have to consider, I have to consider the probability that flu equal to 2, given season equal to 4, congestion equal to 2, and muscle pain equal to false. So this is what I want from the system. Now, I don't have to consider all the 64 variables over here or 64 values over here. When I say the season equal to 4 means 3/4 of my data is getting wiped off because you have to consider only season 4. Okay. Now, congestion equal to 2 means of that true and false of the congestion, I don't have to consider all the choices where season is equal to 4 and congestion is equal to false. Okay, I can skip all those elements. I have to consider only congestion is equal to true case. Then when I come to the last one, that is muscle pain equal to false, again, I can remove all the options in this and I can consider only the muscle pain is equal to false case. So this process is known as factorization, and we will be seeing in detail how it is being done in the coming chapters, maybe in the first chapter, that's probability theory, how to deal with joint distribution is there. And if it is not there, then we will be seeing in the second chapter. Okay, so that is the role of joint distribution in this probability space. So the probability space, which was having 64 different options, is narrowed down to around 17 options. Okay, it was mentioned that there are 17 options in it. Okay, now how it came down to 17 options, I have to work on it, okay? Because this is a little bit complicated system. Okay, but I can go for a simple system wherein the number of spaces are less, then I can tell you how it is coming down and I can explain the factorization in detail. Okay, that I will do in the probability class. Okay, here we are just giving the introduction to BGM. Okay, now you understood the role of probability theory is consider all possible options of that which are the most equally most likely option we can do it by the with the help of joint distribution, which will be considering a query as a joint probability distribution problem. Okay, and this is how we will retrieve the data from it and reduce the probability space. Now we are moving on to the second aspect of it. Okay, we are talking about probabilistic graphical models. So we just dealt with probability. Now we will be seeing the graphical model. Okay, in the graphical model, we use a graph-based representation as a basis for encoding a complex distribution over a high-dimensional space. Okay, so this you have already learned in graph theory. Okay, so I'm just giving you a recap of what you have learned in the graph theory. So in this graphical representation, the nodes corresponds to the variables and the edges corresponds to the probabilistic interactions between them. Okay, now over here, in this particular example, what you can see, these are the nodes, season. These are the variables we have in the data set. That is season, you have flu, you have hay fever, you have muscle pain, you have, and congestion you have. Okay, so these are said to be the nodes of the graph. And what I'm having is the edges. Okay, there are two types of edges, directed and undirected edge. Okay, so here we have a directed edge. So it is moving from season to flu. Okay, here there a number will come. Okay, which will be telling what is the probability of a particular season so that it can get a flu. The flu can be positive, flu can be negative. Okay, either you can represent positive case or you can represent the negative case. So like this, you will be having some numbers over here to represent the probability of the chances. Okay, if you have flu, what is the probability that you can have muscle pain? What is the probability that you can have congestion? So those values will be added over here in a representation manner. So this we will be seeing in detail in the different chapters, because it's a directed graph. You will be having one dimensional data. In undirected graph, you will be having both the flows. That is, in the relation between season to flu also will be there. Flu to season also will be there. Okay, it's a bidirectional data. So when I have bidirectional data, the representation will be different. So that we will be seeing in detail in the coming classes. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you about. Now, one of the most important property of the graph is that the set of independencies that it hold in the distribution. Okay, so whether the nodes in the graph are dependent or independent can represent it by the, like this. Okay, so this is an example, or this is the notation that we are going to use throughout for this, throughout the lectures, for showing the independence. Okay, and what does this indicate? X is independent of Y given Z. Okay, so this is how you can represent the independence between the graph. Okay, so they can be dependent also, independent also. So the dependency can be denoted by X is independent of Y given Z, where X, Y, and Z are variables. Now, in the above example, congestion is independent of season given it is flu or hay fever. Okay, if you know that the person is having flu or the person is having clay fever, hay fever, then the season doesn't come into picture only, because we are discussing about flu. What is the probability that a person is having flu, is having sinus congestion? The person is having hay fever, is having sinus congestion. Okay, it is not going to consider the season at all. Okay, so what does this statement indicates is congestion given flu, hay fever, season is equal to congestion given flu or hay fever. So your season is not going to give any information directly to this congestion, but when I say that the season is not going to give any information to flu to congestion, doesn't mean that congestion is independent of season. Okay, it is just meaning that if I know the flu is there or hay fever is there or not there, then that information is more than enough to validate whether the congestion is there or not. I don't require the information about the season to validate about the congestion. That is what this independence looks like. Okay, now I will give a small exercise for you. I am only talking throughout. So find out the independencies in the graph given below. Okay, so season, flu, hay fever, muscle pain, and congestion are there. Now, I have given a shortcut over here, because if I try to write season, hay fever, flu, and all those things, it's going to take a lot of time. So season can be represented by S, flu can be represented by F, hay fever by H, muscle pain by M, and congestion by C. And try to write the independencies in terms of this particular notation. All of you are there, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So just tell me the independencies that you have. You can write in the chat window. Okay, don't break your head to write the ulta T. Okay, instead of ulta T, you write T only. Okay, in the chat window, you can write. And instead of ulta T, you can write T. So the first one I will give you, congestion is, we already discussed that. Okay, congestion space T space I will write. Okay, so you can write like this. But I will not use T because that is a little bit confusion. Okay, I'll use something like dollar sign or something. Okay, dollar given season. Okay. So condition is independent of season given. Flu or hay fever can be written like this. Okay, all of you are seeing the chat window, right? So similarly, you have to identify other independencies in the graph. Okay, do you want my help? What about muscle pain? Is the muscle pain dependent on season? No. Okay, so you can write as muscle pain is independent of season given flu. Yes, Sarah have written it. Okay, muscle pain is independent of season given flu and hay fever. Correct, that is also correct. Now, what about flu? Flu is independent of hay fever. Flu is independent of hay fever given the season. Hay fever is independent of flu given the season. So these are some of the independencies that you have in this particular graph. Okay, that also you can consider. The parallel independence also you can consider. Okay, so flu is independent of hay fever given season, and hay fever is independent of flu given season. Okay. So you know how to identify the independences. Good.
Ma'am, you just said we can even consider parallel independence, right?
We can consider, I told.
Okay.
See, because this graph can have a direction over here also, okay? This is an exceptional case in which it is not directed over here. Okay, the flu can have an directed arrow from flu to hay fever and hay fever to flu, which is not there. Okay?
Ma'am, I put a message in the chat. Is that correct? I just modified your first text. That congestion is independent of season and muscle pain given flu and hay fever.
Yes, that's also correct. There are different independencies. Okay, it is not necessary, but only that independency should be correct. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. That is what we have discussed. Okay, we will conclude this particular part and we'll go to the next topic. Okay, now you can have independencies at the same level also. There also you can consider it. It's not wrong when you consider independence between the parallel variables. Okay, this I told from level 1, level 2 and level 3 is just for your understanding purpose. But when we come to we are talking about Bayesian network, okay, which is a directed graph. When we come to the second type of networks, which is known as Markov networks, it is going to have multiple connectivity. Okay, so there again, we are going to consider independence. So there is no levels over there. Okay, so here is this is an exceptional case wherein they are not related to each other. Okay, now coming to probabilistic graphical models. Rather than encoding the probability of every possible assignment, we break it up into smaller factors and define overall joint distribution. Okay, so what we do is, we have already seen this, there is spring, no flu, hay fever, congestion, and muscle pain can be obtained by five numbers, multiplying five numbers, that is probability that season equal to spring into probability that flu equal to falls and season equal to spring, probability that hay fever is equal to true, season equal to spring. Probability that congestion equal to true when hay fever is equal to true and flu equal to false, and probability that muscle pain is equal to true when flu is equal to false. So like that, you can consider, given these five parameters, you can consider the any particular event. Okay, now what is the event over here? What is the condition? What is the probability that I can have hay fever, congestion, and muscle pain, given the season is spring and I don't have flu? Okay, so this will enable you. This is a simple example which will enable you to identify between whether I have a flu or a hay fever. Okay, so like this, you will be having different number of parameters and more number of parameters and the relationship between the parameters. Okay, now coming to our last topic in this overview, that is graphical representation. Okay, now we've already discussed probabilistic and how the joint distribution is helping you to eliminate the different factors. Graphical, we were discussing how to consider the independence between the graph so that you can go ahead and explore more. Okay, and now coming to the family of graphical representations. Okay, there are two different types of graphical representation. That is, we call them to be Bayesian networks. Okay, in probability theory, we'll be talking something else. But in machine learning or any artificial intelligence topic, we are going to consider them to be two types of network. The first network is called to be Bayesian network because it is going to use a directed graph where edges have a source and a target. Okay, so there is a direction of the flow of information from the node to the source node to the destination node or a target node. Okay, so we have the first class of systems to be Bayesian networks, and we have the second module entirely devoted for this particular type of networks, how to model them and so on. The second part of it is called Markov networks. The Markov networks uses an undirected graph. Okay. Now, when I have an undirected graph, the connection is between, the mutual connection is there between the source and the destination. Okay. So there is one connection going from source to target and the other connection going coming from source direct target to source. Okay, so we can't say source and target over here. So here there will be two nodes. Okay, so that such type of networks are known as Markov networks, which is going to be a bit complicated compared to Bayesian networks because you have to consider both the directions. But it has a wide range of application compared to Bayesian networks because mostly the variables tend to relate with each other. It is not that one variable is giving information to other variable. Okay, so they are going to be dependent on each other. That is why Markov networks is having a wide range of application compared to Bayesian networks. And the third module is about hidden Markov networks. So hidden Markov networks is like I am going from one node to another node. Okay, node one to node two. And from node two, I reach node three. Then node two doesn't have any relevance. What I mean by doesn't have any relevance means node two will be carrying all the information corresponding to it, and then it will be moving to node three. So such type of networks are known as hidden Markov networks, which we will be seeing in the fourth module. Okay, so that also have a wide range compared to Markov networks. It has another wide range of applications because whenever I am skipping from one node to another node, I would like to carry all the information contained from one node to another so that I can skip it. Otherwise, what happens? I have to come back and see what is happening every time. Okay, so whenever we try to model systems, we generally prefer to use hidden Markov models wherever possible, but in all the cases you cannot do that. Maybe the information content of one node is going to be too high so that it can get carried over to another node. Then we go for normal Markov networks. So both will be having the same methodology. Only thing is like the in-between node information in-between node can be disconsidered or not considered when I move from one node to another node. Okay, so this will give an better representation. So it too can be viewed if you consider Markov networks, because we have seen Bayesian network as an example. It too can be viewed as set of independence assertions and Comback factorization of the distribution. That is, even consider season and flu are dependent to each other. Okay, so for example, if I have flu, then you can predict what is the season. Okay, so and if I have season, I can predict what is the flu. So that is the interrelated component. Okay, so if they are mutually related, you will be having the relationship or the probability distribution between both the sides, that is flu and the season and season and the flu. Okay, so that encoding is possible. Only thing, both arrows will be having two different probability values. Like my arrow from season to flu will be having one value, and flu back to season will be having another value. Okay, so these both provide duality of independencies and factorization. So all the principles that is lying behind all these methodologies is going to be same, and they differ in the set of independencies they encode, because wherever I am going to do the independencies, I have to consider in both the directions and in the factorization methodology that you're going to use, which we will be seeing in detail in the third and the fourth module. Now coming to the last topic of PGM, that is representation, inference, and learning. So what is the advantage of PGM is, we will see what are the advantages. The first one is the distribution can be written down tractably. That is, in this particular, this diagram that we have got for the disease, right, for example, can be from a data set where all these five parameters are there, and we have found the relationship between them, okay, based on the different influence, different factors in it. Okay, so this is going to give you a very broad information, and it is a very, in a very narrow case over here, when I when I specify the different seasons and the probabilities and all those things in this particular graph, it's a very compact representation compared to the entire data set of maybe 2,000 or 20,000 tuples, which all these five variables in it. Okay, so that is the first advantage. The second advantage is framework can be transparent, that a human expert can understand and evaluate the semantics and properties. That is, when I have this particular diagram in hand, and it is saying that the season is equal to fall, the chance of flu and hay fever is high. Okay, so anyone who is referring to this particular diagram will be able to understand it. Okay, so anyone who knows about flu and this thing, then it will be able to understand, okay, when it is winter, there are more chances of having the flu and the hay fever compared to summer. Okay, so that is that is very transparent, and it was very easy for humans to interpret. The third one, the models can be opaque also. Okay, and we are interested in models that are opaque because that easily give rise to unexplained and even undesirable answers. Now, have you heard about market basket analysis? What is it? That is, whenever I have built a supermarket, and when I bring, when I keep the things together, I generally keep bread and butter together. Why bread and butter together? Because the chance of bread, if I take the bread, the chance of buying the butter is small. So if a person is walking around the supermarket, what he will do, first he will take bread, and immediately if he sees butter, he will take the butter, right? So like this, you can increase the sale in the supermarket, okay? So that type of unexplained, that is the, which doesn't give any much explanation, like this was, this is a very naive fact, okay, naive fact. Everyone knows that bread and butter goes together. But how to put it in the supermarket, and what is the effect of it, came into existence only when the supermarket concept came into picture, right? So such kind of unexplained facts can be derived from this method. And that is what we are interested in. Okay, being data science engineers, we are interested in most of the models that are opaque in nature, which is not transparent. Okay, so the inference will be, now that even though we know that bread and butter goes together, we have to keep it together in the store, gave rise only recently when people did market basket analysis. Okay, so such type of discoveries are more important for us. Now, the second advantage is it can be used effectively for inference, because directly you are using joint distributions, so answering queries is going to be very easy for you. Now, algorithms can use posterior probability. That is, what is the chance that I am having fever given my symptoms? Okay, so that type of probability evaluation is also possible. That is why that is another advantage of PGM. Now, the last one is a data-driven approach. So we are coming back to the same thing only. A human expert can provide some rough guidelines. Okay, he may not be able to give all the guidelines, but some rough guidelines can be given to the model of a given domain. And it should encode all the main dependencies. And then with the help of this human-created model, you can fit the model to the data that is available. That is the data set that you are having. You can try to fit in the data, and then it will give you reveal surprising connections between variables and provide novel insights about the domain. Okay, so this is the most important part of why we are teaching, why we are learning PGM. Okay, so we know that the variables are there, your data set is there, the data is there. Now, how to get the insights about the data? That is what we are interested about. And if I start with a small model, which is a human expert created model, and if I try to fit in the data using some algorithms on it, then what happens? There will be some connections or some connections between variables which will be providing a new insight about the data, like the market basket analysis. Okay, so generally nowadays you can see in the supermarkets they keep all these things together. What is first breakfast items together? Okay, then within that particular item also bread and butter together, or curd and milk together. Like that, they use a lot of logic just to increase the sale, and we end up in buying more when you go to supermarket. Okay, so that is the logic behind it. Now, these three components, that is representation, how to represent it in data, where we will be using propositional logic, inference, that we will be like representing it in terms of the if-then rules. Okay, if I have fever, then what is the chance that I have muscle pain or congestion, etc. And learning. The last one, learning is taking place when we or modeling, we try to fit the model. Okay, are critical components in constructing any intelligence system. And PGM is one of a small handful of framework which will support all three capabilities. That is, it has inference in it, representation in it, and learning in it, so that you will have all the capabilities of an AI system to build the system and use it for the real world applications. Okay, so with this, I am concluding the introduction to PGM. From next lecture, we will be starting with the syllabus content, that is introduction to probability theory, introduction to graphs and the models and the application. Okay, so thank you very much.